Good morning, students. Today we will study the fifth part of molecular basis of biology. Just to recall, you know the central dogma of biology, that is DNA is producing mRNA through the process called transcription. mRNA then produces proteins through the process of translation. DNA can replicate, so the process is called replication. Okay, so this much you just recall back, and we have already studied DNA replication and the transcription. And if you observe what we had studied in transcription, just to recall back, you know your DNA, which is double stranded, which is anti-parallel strands. So in that, one strand stores the genetic information, the other strand has the information complementary to the genetic information strand. When I say genetic information strand, I'm talking about the sense strand. So the complementary to the strand complementary to sense strand is your antisense strand. Now, don't get confused much. What you have to remember is there is one code written over here which you are not able to understand. Only the cell can understand. Only a particular enzyme can understand. So this is your a segment of DNA that codes for a character. So we call it as a gene. This gene is transcribed into a single-stranded mRNA. Okay, single-stranded mRNA. Don't look at this line. I'm just striking it off. Don't look at that line because you are studying what that line is today. Okay, so this is your mRNA. mRNA has again the nitrogenous bases. Finally, this mRNA is decoded. See, from DNA to RNA, it was coding. From mRNA to proteins, it is decoding. Why decoding? We are getting the final product. That is your amino acid sequence to form your polypeptide. So, as this is produced, the protein gets produced, we have to also remember the other three RNAs that are showing their roles during translation process. So you can see tRNA is there already, which carries the respective amino acid. Okay, then there is your mRNA already that is produced by transcription. Then you will understand about one more, that is your ribosomal RNA, which acts like the catalyst. So without any delay, I'm going further for the explanation. So before we understand about the translation process, let us understand about the code, okay, the language used for the transfer of genetic information from DNA to final product. Okay, till the final product is formed, how the transfer of information is and in what language. Of course, the language you can see in DNA and in RNA, that is your nitrogenous bases, or you can say nucleotides. Okay, together you can say sequence of nucleotides, and final product after translation, final product is your polypeptide. So it consists of the sequence of amino acids. You know very well proteins are made up of amino acid. So let us understand what that genetic code is. Okay, so there's a general sentence, a relationship between the sequence of nucleotides. See, please note, sequence of nucleotides on mRNA and the sequence of amino acids in the polypeptide. So we are trying to bring the relationship, so giving the word genetic code. So that code will be decoded when it is in the polypeptide chain. Now let me just give you know about A, G, T, C. These are your nitrogenous bases. So when it is bound with your sugar phosphate, we say nucleotides. Okay, we call it as nucleotides. Now I'm talking about your code. When I say code, there is one more thing which you have to remember. As we understand what that code is, of course it is this न्यूक्लियोटाइड सीक्वेंस, ओके, इट इज़ द न्यूक्लियोटाइड सीक्वेंस, बट वी हैव टू नो हाउ द यू नो रीडिंग ऑफ द सीक्वेंस टेक्स प्लेस. इज इट वन न्यूक्लियोटाइड एट अ टाइम और मोर देन वन? सो देवे मेनी साइंटिस्ट, देवे मेनी साइंटिस्ट. द फर्स्ट पर्सन हु गेव द आइडिया अबाउट डिसिफरिंग, सॉरी डिसाइफरिंग, इट इज डिसाइफर, ओके, द प्रोनाउंसिएशन, डिसाइफरिंग द कोड, द मीनिंग ऑफ डिसाइफरिंग आई हैव रिटन इट बिलो, टू कन्वर्ट अ कोड टू नॉर्मल लैंग्वेज, ओके, दैट इज कॉल्ड एज डिसाइफरिंग द कोड. सो how the scientists were like curious about what that code is. Soon after Watson and Crick gave the model, they gave the DNA replication, okay, these scientists gave a little more ideas about what translation process could be, okay. So Francis and Crick gave the idea of central dogma, so that was a basic knowledge which made the other scientists curious to go to the deeper knowledge of how and what is happening, okay. So that's why we are saying about the code which is been decoded to understand what is actual process, how the reading of the strand takes place to form your final product, okay. It is not that easy, it took a long time. So first person was your George Gamow. Though he was a physicist, he had stated, he showed a lot of interest, and he stated that there are only four bases. You know your four bases, A, G, T, and C. Only four bases are there. And if they have to code for 20 amino acids, remember, at present we have 21 amino acids. Now we are saying we have 20 amino acids, and a protein can be made out of the 20 amino acids. It can reoccur any number of times. But a perfect sequence of amino acid can give the functional protein. Okay. So only a functional protein, when I say, it is functional enzyme. It can do its work. So out of that amino acid, I'm talking about the sequence. You know about your, as I said earlier, when I say code, I'm talking about the sequence of nitrogenous base, okay. And here I'm saying about the amino acid, there are 20 amino acid, okay, and there are only four bases. How can, if imagine it was only one single base that is coding for the amino acid, we have to code for 20 amino acid, and here only four bases are there. Therefore, they thought it is not the single base that is acting. So, it could be your, they started taking polymers. So, there were two more scientists, Nirenberg and Khurana. Okay, Hargobind Khurana. Those two went a little more depth. So, they went for first the paired bases. So, they took in two ways, homopolymers, that is AA lathas. It could be two bases together, so paired bases together, they may be coding for the particular amino acid. But ultimately, it came to know that if you just calculate, like this, if you do the paired one, you will only get around 16, okay, 16 amino acids, okay. So bases can code for 16 amino acids, but we have 20 amino acids. So I'm not going depth, okay, because this is not important. I'm just giving you an idea how the scientists were digging into the matter. Finally, it was identified by Khurana and Hargobind Khurana and Marshall Nirenberg. So they first went for homopolymers. So when I say homopolymers, he took a single base sequence, okay, repetitive sequence that was of single base. So this is how he had selected, and then he finalized it is three bases that code for the amino acid. So UUU codes for phenylalanine. We give the short term PHE, phenylalanine. So this is how he got phenylalanine chain. Though this polypeptide was not functional, we want what amino acid is coded by the language written in mRNA. Okay, when I say U, remember U is uracil or uridine in mRNA. So that's how the idea of three nucleotides that give that code for a single amino acid. And when he tried, so it was the idea given by George Gamow. So he said to code for 20 amino acid, it can't be one or two bases that can code for the amino acid. It can be three. So he said the code should consist of the combination of bases. So in the permutation combination of 4 to the power 3, please note, it is 4 to the power 3. So when I say 4 to the power 3, I am saying 4 into 4 into 4. That can generate 64 codons. Now what are codons? Triplet code, triplet bases are called as codons. Okay. So just now earlier I just showed you. This is your codon, triplet in nature. Codon is triplet in nature. So we have, in general we say, in DNA, RNA and your protein, so when I say DNA, RNA and protein, DNA has the genetic code. RNA, that is your mRNA, has your codon. I hope you're getting the idea. I'll give you a better idea with the picture later on. Then proteins will have amino acid. I'm sure you're writing the short form here. Please note, genetic information that is present on DNA is genetic code. That genetic code is written in the form of codons or read as codons. Okay, it is read as, reading as codons. Then this codons will code for the amino acid, specific amino acid that will build the final protein. Okay, so let me just show you the picture here. So have you got some idea? This is your DNA genetic code. Where is the genetic code? We are specially taking antisense strand. It is having the code of the information strand, that is sense strand. Okay, information is on sense. Who is coding that sense strand? The antisense. So code is in this line, the one which I am striking. This line is having the code. The code is then transferred into mRNA. We call it in triplet form. So it is already, you know, demarcated. So you can see AUG, that is one codon, GGG, that codes for, that is another codon. So you can see below what is the amino acid it codes for. AUG for methionine, we write MET. GGG, so AUG is a copolymer, GGG is a homopolymer. So like that, this is how they we are selecting. But don't worry, that's not very in detail required for you. This is only the basic concept which you should understand. Okay, so I hope the terms homopolymer and copolymers you have understood. Okay, then coming to in between, you can find anticodon. So the word anticodon is here, which is difficult for you to read. Don't worry, this part I'll come later on. Okay, the one which I've striked, I'm coming later on. So till here you've understood what translation is, what genetic code is. So just showing this genetic code, that's what he said, the Gamow, George Gamow's 4 into 4 into 4. That is, when I say 4, he's talking about this 64 codons. So U and U, again, there are separate nitrogenous bases here. Okay. This is how total, if you find, there are 64 codons. It took a very long time. Okay, very long time. So here there are all these scientists which you can see. It began with Gamow and then Hargobind Khorana, Marshall Nirenberg. They came forward with the chemical method. So this was a proof. This was theoretical. What Gamow gave was a theoretical idea. And the proof was given by Hargobind Khorana and Marshall Nirenberg. So they also used the enzyme polynucleotide phosphorylase. The another name is here, Siviro-Oka enzyme. Then that's how finally they had come to a conclusion with the checkerboard. Okay, they had proved Gamow's idea, and that's how they came with this particular checker box to say there are 64 codons, and each codons they've given a specific amino acid. See, observe here what is the case. See, first one is UUU, phenylalanine. I'm just taking in random. Okay, then here CUC, that is leucine. Then there is your UAU, tyrosine. So these are your amino acid and this is your codon. So here that's what they've given. Codons coding for various amino acid. So in this, you can observe the three useless codons. 1, 2, 3. You can see that it is written as stop. So it's highlighted here. I've highlighted it in a better picture. So you can see there are stop codons. Okay. And please note here, it's highlighted to say this is the start codon. Universally accepted, studied properly, and then said every organism has a start codon. For any gene, there is a start codon. It is a common codon called AUG, which codes for methionine. One mark question. And again, this is universal. Stop codons, it is universal. They do not code for any amino acid. Okay, they do not code for any amino acid. Totally, out of the 64 codons, 3 are useless. Okay, they do not code for any amino acid. And hence, these 3 are called as your nonsense codons, or you can say stop codons. Those 2 words we can term them. Then the rest 61 are your codons. Okay, they are your codons. These are your stop codons, the ones which are highlighted here. Okay, this is your salient features. 5 mark question, compulsory question. I have to say, not compulsory, but most frequently asked. Okay, most frequently asked question. So the salient features, first, as I've told before, when I say codon, it is having 3 bases. So it is triplet. Okay, it is triplet in nature. First, you have to remember the salient feature. It is triplet in nature. Then, please even note, there are 64 codons. Out of that, 61 codes for amino acid and 3 do not code for any amino acid. And please note to remember to write it down, the 3 stop codons. It's easy to remember. One is UAA, UGA, UAG. This last one is just interchanging, GA and AG. So first one UAA, UAG, UGA. So those are your stop codons. 3 mark question. Mention the stop codons. Okay. So you've understood about the triplet and how it codes. There are 61 that codes and 3 codons that do not code for amino acid. Second feature, it is unambiguous and specific. When I say unambiguous and specific, it means one codon codes for only one amino acid. So you saw the box earlier. You can't find more than one amino acid. It is single amino acid. Okay. So here I'm saying one codon, one amino acid. That's why it is unambiguous and specific. UUU cannot be giving serine. It cannot give serine. It has to give phenylalanine. That is what we are saying specific. Okay? Then, some amino acids are coded by more than one codon. For example, you can see clearly, phenylalanine amino acid is coded by more than one codon. Yes, phenylalanine is coded by UUU and UUC. So you can easily see here. Even here, if you see arginine, it is coded by four codons. Okay, four codons are coding the same amino acid. But remember, one codon can code only one amino acid. But the amino acid can be coded by different codons. So here you can see example. Any example you can select. For example, leucine. First and second base is proper, then the third base is U, C, A, G. Okay, earlier I wanted to, I'll rectify what mistake I'd done. I said the code A, G, T, C, right? Please note, when I come to mRNA, it is T replaced to U. I forgot to mention that T replaces to U. That's why we have in your codon the base uracil, okay? So you can find that uracil base. So we are talking on mRNA, the codon. Code is where? On DNA, okay? DNA has code, RNA has codon, and your polypeptide or your protein has amino acids. Okay, the third feature is code is degenerate. Okay, that's what I had explained. It means degenerate. Amino acids are coded by more than one codon. The previous example I had shown earlier. You can see here, leucine is coded by four codons. This is called degenerate. Code is degenerate. Then there are no punctuations. When I say no punctuations, let me just give you an example. AUG, as I said earlier, it is the first start codon. After AUG, I'll just give you random. UUU. GUG. So, I'm giving triplet right now. Now, when we are reading, it should not be like 1, 2, 3. Then like this, I'll just give the other color so you can identify. 1, 2, 3. Again. 1, 2, 3. What I'm trying to say is, triplet code. Okay, triplet code. The codon, when we read as triplet, we have to remember it should not be overlapped with the next codon. Okay, whatever I've done is totally wrong. Overlapping is not there. So it should be AUG, one codon, then it is the next codon. Okay, UUU, GUG. This is how the reading takes place. First codon, okay, there is no punctuation, like, okay, there is no overlapping, there is no comma like this. We don't show comma. So when we are writing, we write it continuous. AUG, UUU, GUG. So do you find any space bar or a comma or a bar anywhere? So definitely we don't write like that. So first thing, we don't show what I'm showing here. AUG, UUU, GUG. Now, which is the right method? This one. Which is the wrong method? The one with the punctuations. Punctuations should not be there. Then, is the reading done overlapping method? No, this is not to be followed. How is the reading method? It is first three, AUG, then it is UUU. So like that it is followed. Okay, one after the other it is. So after one, it is second and third. So it should be non-overlapping and no punctuation. So I hope the terms are clear. So it is in your contiguous fashion. When I say contiguous, adjacent. I'm saying adjacent. After AUG, adjacent to it is UUU. That is how, contiguous manner. So there are no punctuations. They should not have any comma in between. It should be like close to each other. The codons will be close to each other with no gaps and no punctuations. So such fashion is called as contiguous fashion. And this code is accepted universally. Every organism has this particular, now example I've given, UUU. This particular codon is present in every organism. And in every organism, UUU codes for phenylalanine. Okay? So this is why we are saying, since it is present in all organisms, we call it as universal. The coding language is universal. Okay? Sequence can be, when I say sequence of the DNA, RNA, it can be any. But I'm talking about the code. A codon, for example, UUU, will always code for phenylalanine. Always. This is called as universal. And then finally, you're just giving about the initiator codon, which has dual functions. One, it gives the specific amino acid. And second, it is the start codon. To begin or initiate any protein synthesis, it is the presence of initiator codon to begin it. Okay? So this is, you have understood. Please remember that is a 5-mark question. Now we are just coming to the point of mutation. You understood till now the mutation in general about karyotype, about chromosome, about some point mutation. But now you are getting a little better idea. If there is mutation in the genetic code, what will happen? For example, now this is just from your textbook I've just removed. Now look at this sentence. It has some, please remember this is only for an idea. We are giving sentences. So it is Ram has red cap. Your sentence makes sense. Now we are talking about mutation. Mutation can be single base that could be added or changed, or that is what we are saying. So here you just observe. There's a mutation. The red color one is a mutation. So just observe what is happening. There is an insertion of a letter. Now can you read the sentence? Ram has whatever. I don't make sense if I read it. So even if I start reading it, I cannot read after that. This is called mutation. Now imagine I am the enzyme who is reading the strand and producing the protein. Okay? So if I am, me being the enzyme, identifies the error, I cannot go further because it really doesn't make sense at this region. So I stop the work. Don't you think this is kind of a mutation? When I say mutation, there is some defect. Okay? Mutation can be beneficial. So as we see, every time mutation occurs, we can find the insertion, and then finally, mutation is sensible. At one stage, it is sensible. So what is that? So as that letters keep adding up, a new word is formed, a new code is formed. So Ram has big red cap. This is how it is changed. See whatever the idea that comes from the first sentence and the final sentence because of the mutations, reoccurring mutations. So you can clearly say, an insertion, a deletion can cause changes in the character, changes in whatever. Now, for example, here you can find the sentence that is making difference in the sense. Okay, so here, I hope it is clear. Similarly, we are talking about the deletion. Deletion that can lead to either it is beneficial or harmful or defective. So, this is what we explain here. Okay, your point mutation change at the single base pair in the gene, or frame shift mutation. So that will occur at either at like one or two bases, or it is like a reading frame segment of DNA. So you have already studied that. I'm not going in detail. So this is how you have to remember. There is something called silent mutation. When I say silent mutation, let me first show you about that. We call the term observe here. Now I have CUC. CUC. Okay. Now the first base is fine, second base is fine. If the third base, okay, if the third base was mutating, okay, if third base was mutating, what will it turn to? CUG. Imagine it turns to CUG. What does it code for? Just observe here. Only in some cases, okay, this is called a silent mutation. Though it has changed, it doesn't affect much. Why? It codes for the same amino acid. CUC was coding for leucine. After the mutation in the third nitrogenous base of the codon, it is still coding for leucine. This means mutation occurred but not visible. This is called as your silent mutation. Okay, so this is your Wobble hypothesis, which is not discussed. Wobble hypothesis, where the third third nitrogenous base is like a Wobble. You know what is Wobble? It is like shaking, keeps changing or keeps jumping. Even if it is jumping, okay, it doesn't affect the gene. It does not affect the gene. It does not affect the genetic code, because in certain cases, the third nucleotide, even if it is changes, it codes still for the same amino acid. So first and second amino acid should be same, and the third, sorry, first and second nucleotide should be same. The third nucleotide will be like a Wobble, will be jumping. So it can be U, the third nucleotide, U, C, A, G, any. All four, if you observe, first and second nucleotide is same. Okay, so we are saying this is your Wobble hypothesis, or you can say about the term silent mutation. Okay, so this is how we can say, even if it creates mutation, so it is not going to be severe. Mutation is there, but it is not severe. Why not severe? Because of the, you can say, the redundancy, the third nitrogenous base, even though it mutates, it does not affect the coding. So you know about the example already. Now we have understood about the genetic code. Now we are coming to the important molecule called adapter molecule, that is the tRNA. So before we understand the process of translation, you should know the structure of tRNA. Why we should know? Because tRNA is the one which will bring the amino acid for the polypeptide synthesis. So it was again Francis Crick postulated that this tRNA, okay, is an adapter molecule. And what that adapter molecule will do? One hand it will read the code, other hand it will bind to the specific amino acid. So it was earlier called soluble RNA or sRNA. So I hope it is clear. What is sRNA? It was earlier called sRNA, now called tRNA. Why it is called adapter molecule? Because it could one hand read the code, other hand bind to the specific amino acid. So what is that? Just see, observe the structure. Now, one hand, look at the one hand that has anticodon. Now the word anticodon has come. Okay, so anticodon which will be complementary to codon. You just observe anticodon and codon. Anti means opposite to something. So here codon, here it is anticodon. Similar to your word sense and antisense. So you understood about the one hand carrying anticodon, that codes for the codon. Okay, codes for the specific amino acid. So, other hand, the tRNA will carry the specific amino acid. So, that is the dual role of tRNA. That's why it is called adapter molecule. So, if you observe the structure of your adapter molecule, you can see it is your clover shape. You know, your clove. Okay, we draw it like this, right? The clove. So, similar to that it is. It is inverted here. So, 3-mark question can be asked. So, before I go into detail, there is your different structures here. Let me just show you what is written here. There is your anticodon loop. Okay, when I say anticodon loop, I'm talking about the anticodon. Now, AUG was your initiator codon, right? On the mRNA. On the tRNA, we have anticodon. What is that? Opposite to the AUG. That is UAC. Okay, this is anticodon. Okay, I hope it is understood. That's what the sentence is here. That has the base complemented to the code. It is better you write codon. Okay. Or you can say codon mRNA. In one word, codon. Okay. One word codon or codon mRNA. Then there is your amino acid acceptor end. When I say acceptor end, it is this end. Observe here. They have written already amino acid attachment site. Then there is your DHU arm, TCC arm, variable arm, which they have not pointed out. So, you need not worry about it. Okay. So, don't worry much. So, there are two structures which you should remember. Two-dimensional, three-dimensional. When I say two-dimensional, it is your clover leaf model. And then it is your 3D model, that is inverted L. This is inverted L. Inverted L shape. This is simplified. Okay, we are just generally giving for representation. Need not worry about it. All you have to know is your 2D and the 3D structure. Okay, you draw from the diagram which is there in the textbook. Some will have the L shape. Some will have the clover model shape. So, this is your clover model. So, if the question is asked for 3 marks, draw a neat label diagram of tRNA. Please remember to draw this. So, this is asked for 2 marks. Not to draw both. Anyone you can draw. Either this or this. Anyone you can draw. But see that you are giving the labelings properly. Okay. So, you should know a little more about tRNA. First, it's, you know, they are specific for each amino acid. Then, for initiation, there is initiator called tRNA. For initiation, there is initiator tRNA. As I said earlier, you know about your mRNA having AUG as your initiator codon. So, the anticodon will be UAC. Okay. So, it will be carrying, this initiator tRNA will be carrying methionine. Then there are no tRNAs for stop codons. Of course, yes. Stop codons do not code for any amino acid. Therefore, no tRNAs. Then as I said, the 2D model or secondary structure, clover leaf model. Then there is your actual structure, the compact molecule or 3D model, inverted L shape. So, this is again in detail. So, observe what's happening. So, let me come directly to translation now. Before I go for translation process, let us understand the translational unit of on mRNA. So, whether it is in eukaryotes or prokaryotes, we are just saying in general. You know your mRNA, you remember mRNA? It has a cap, it has a poly A tail, and it has a coding region. Those are your exons. So, when this translation occurs, when I say translation, I'm talking about the ribosomal units. Can you see 60S, 40S? So, 60 and 40 gives 80S. ATAs together. So this is in case of eukaryotes. When I say prokaryotes will have 70S ribosomal unit. So when I say 70S, it is above is 50, below is 30S. Please remember to write S. Okay. Now, I'm not going into detail right now. First is your basic. So there is your 5 prime end, a cap. Then there is UTR. UTR means untranslated regions. Okay, untranslated regions. So it is found in the initial and the later strands. Later sequences, you can say, of the mRNA strand. So here in between you can find your coding region which is continuous. So it begins with your AUG and then follows up and ends with your stop codons. So stop codons are present in your UTR. That's why they are called as your untranslated. UTR, full form, untranslated regions. So I hope you got one idea. Now if you observe here, it is polyribosome. Polyribosome. One mRNA has many ribosomes. So this is in case of polycistronic. This is only one ribosome on one mRNA. Monocistronic. So I hope the words are clear. Monocistronic, polycistronic. Here each will be giving your polypeptide chains. That means there are many genes on this mRNA. That's why polycistronic. In your prokaryotes, here example is for eukaryotes, okay, that is monocistronic. One ribosome is only reading the coding region. Now please remember, now you understood about mRNA, you understood about tRNA, now it is your rRNA. Ribosome has two units, okay, so larger subunit, smaller subunit. As I said earlier, if it was ATS, that is in eukaryotes. Okay, in eukaryotes, it is ATS unit. So, subunits are 60S and 40S. Then, in case of prokaryotes, 70S. So, it will be 50S and 30S. Okay, I hope it is clear. So without any delay, I'm just going further. When I say translation, I've selected the definition in orange for you because that is what I've taken from the textbook. The others which you can just follow up and gives you a better idea. In one sentence, biosynthesis of proteins from mRNA. Okay, otherwise, follow this definition. The process of translation that requires transfer of genetic information from a polymer of nucleotides to a polymer of amino acid. Even this is from your textbook. Translation specifically means process of polymerization of amino acids to form polypeptide. But you have to mention from mRNA. Okay, from mRNA. So please remember these, one of the definitions which you are finding it easy, please remember it. Here one thing we have to add is from mRNA, okay. So this is what you can see, 5 prime to 3 prime mRNA. There is your tRNA, that is one is going, one is coming, okay. So tRNA, so you can see tRNA that has amino acid. And after it comes here, there is your peptide bond formation. You know peptide bond, right? So it is between the two amino acids. The bond is called as peptide bond. After the bond formation, this chain shifts onto the next tRNA. The previous one will leave out. So when it leaves out, does it have the amino acid? No. So first one entry, amino acid is there. When it exits, amino acid is not there. So this is why we say charged, uncharged, okay. This is called as charged tRNA. And in case of absence of amino acid, uncharged tRNA. So I hope it is clear. Observe here, there is your small subunit and the large subunit. So small subunit is attached to the strand for the reading. Reading again in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime. So you have to just remember before we go into the detailed process. So the order and the sequence of amino acids are defined by the bases in the mRNA. So how the order is? It is based on the mRNA sequence. Okay. So the same sequence will be your amino acid sequence. Okay. It is not random. How the sequence is on mRNA, that's how it is. Your amino acid is formed. Then bond is your peptide bond. Then to catalyze the reaction, ribosome is the one which acts as a catalyst. So it is your 23S RNA in bacteria, that is the enzyme name ribozyme. Okay, enzyme name ribozyme. 1 mark question, what is ribozyme? A ribosome that acts as a catalyst, that is 23S RNA in bacteria. Okay, so ribozyme is your rRNA itself. So here in bacteria they have highlighted the sediment 23S. S means sediment unit or your Swedberg unit. So first one, charging of tRNA is there. So when I say process, charging of tRNA, I hope you know what is charging. That is seeing that this tRNA will have the specific amino acid. Okay. So initially it will be empty. tRNA will not have the amino acid. So it has to be charged. Okay, it has to be charged. So this is called as charging of tRNA. Then initiation. It's the same steps which will be there for every process. Initiation, elongation, termination. So let me go directly to the process now. And then we'll see if you are finding it difficult or not. First step, amino acylation of tRNA. The word amino acylation, meaning to say your tRNA, okay, I'll just draw a simple diagram, okay, a tRNA having your amino acceptor arm, okay. So when I say amino acceptor arm, let me show the picture for you. So this is your amino acceptor arm. Now looking at this picture, is the amino acid attached? No. They have to attach at the 3 prime end. So once they are attached over here, this is called as amino acyl. Why the word acyl? Because we are using ATP for the binding. We are using ATP for the binding. That's why amino acyl process. So here amino acids are activated in the presence of ATP and linked to their cognate tRNA. When I say cognate, the specific tRNA having your anticodons. For example, let me just show one. Difficult to draw for me here. Okay, what I'm trying to show is the anticodons which are present here. So you know there is AUG, the initiator codon. Okay, AUG codes for what? Methionine, right? It codes for methionine. Now this methionine is an amino acid. This is the initiator tRNA. What do you mean by initiator tRNA? It has anticodons complementary to initiator codon. UAC. So UAC opposite to AUG. Now, when I say amino acylation process, first there is charging. What do you mean by charging? This amino acid will come and bind to the specific tRNA. This specific tRNA having the anticodon, specific anticodon, is called as your cognate tRNA. When I say cognate, it is specific to this amino acid. They are linked to each other. They cannot be separated. Cognate tRNA. So only the anticodon UAC, tRNA having anticodon UAC will be opting methionine as their amino acid activation. Okay. So the first step is done. So the tRNA has the amino acid now. So every tRNAs, many tRNAs will be charged. So the process can be started. How it starts? For initiation, now we are starting with your prokaryotes. So we are using the units 30S, 50S. Prokaryotes 70S. So 70S will be small subuniting, will be having small subunit 30S, large subunit 50S. Now, when I say about the ribosomal units, again I'm just recalling back, one is small unit, one is bigger unit. So bigger unit is 50S, small unit is 30S. So you know your mRNA. We just come back here. You know your mRNA, 5 prime to 3 prime. You know your initiator codon, that is A, U, G. Then there is your small subunit, the 30S subunit that is attached. Okay. Is it clear till here? So once it has come till here, so there is chances of initiator tRNA to enter. Initiator tRNA to enter. Okay, when I say initiator tRNA carrying methionine, observe here what I'm saying. This is AUG, right? So there is your tRNA which has anticodon UAC, which is complementary to AUG, and it carries the amino acid methionine. Okay, and there is your small subunit 30S ribosomal unit, and this is your mRNA. So totally, if you see, there is your mRNA 5 prime to 3 prime. Okay, initiator codon, smaller ribosomal subunit, and then there is your charged tRNA carrying methionine. Okay, initiator tRNA, better word is initiator tRNA on the initiator codon. Okay, so I hope the term's clear now. So ribosomal unit 30S binds to which area? 5 prime end of the mRNA at the start codon AUG, that is recognized by initiator tRNA carrying amino acid methionine. Is it clear? Now this whole structure which I drew earlier is your initiation complex. Okay, it is called as initiation complex. Only after the 50S ribosomal unit subunit binds, translation process begins. Please note, we have said universal AUG is your start codon. In case of bacteria, it is GUG, and it is universal. Okay, GUG, though it codes for valine, okay, in case of bacteria, in certain bacteria only, the initiator codon is GUG. Okay, so initiation codon will be of two types. Majority it is AUG. Exceptional cases in bacteria, in some bacteria, is GUG. So now I'll just tell you the picture here. So when this largest subunit, this is your 50S, this is your 30S. Okay, in this picture they have not shown the smaller subunit, so I'm drawing it. Observe here, देर आर थ्री साइड्स, कैन यू सी ब्लू कलर, ग्रीन कलर एंड रेड कलर, सो यू कैन सी व्हाट्स हैपनिंग देर. One second, I have to show you one picture. Okay, here I've just missed the picture. I'll send the picture later on. In the textbook, it is present. So when I say mRNA, you have your AUG. Okay, and there is your UAC as your codon, U anticodon, UAC anticodon of the tRNA. Okay, and it carries methionine. So this is, let me show one more part, that is ribosome. Okay, ribosome is here, that is a smaller subunit. When the largest subunit comes and occupies, it starts the process. Okay, so you got some idea. When the largest subunit is bound to the smaller subunit of ribosome, then the initiation begins. So this is your, let me just say in better words, when the 50S subunit, ribosomal subunit, binds to the initiation complex. What do you mean by initiation complex? mRNA, initiator codon, 30S your rRNA, that is ribosome, and the initiator tRNA. This together constitute initiation complex. How will it initiate? Just by adding 50S ribosomal subunit. So I hope it is clear. That is how it begins the process. That's what I've written here. Only after it binds, process will begin. So here you should know, in your ribosome, there are three sites actually, which I've only mentioned two over here. So first let me explain you that site. So this is your, you know, how activation occurs. Okay, when I'm saying activation of tRNA with the help of ATP, how the specific amino acid gets charged. So I'm not going in detail. So this is one enzyme, aminoacyl tRNA synthetase. Okay, that is the enzyme for charging of tRNA. Let me just draw and show you. Wait. Okay, now you have your mRNA, you have your many sequences. Let me just give, for example, first one is AUG, then UUU, GUG. Okay, now you know about the initiator codon having the initiator tRNA UAC, right? And it carries methionine. And I have told you about the ribosome, small unit, small subunit, that is 30S is here, larger one is here. There is one more site, okay, one more site, which allows for the next tRNA. So observe, as I'm giving a little zoomed portion, A, U, G, U, U, U. Okay, this is continuous. I'm just showing gap, so I can show what I have to explain about the process. This is your 30S subunit, right? And this is your long one, the bigger one, that is your larger subunit, 50S. Now in this 50S, there are two sites. One is A site, then there is P site. Sorry, P site. Now when I say P site, this is your peptide bond formation, A site for the incoming tRNA. So there is first tRNA and that will enter here. I'm very sorry, I wrote the wrong terms. This should be P, this should be A. I'll explain again.
AUGUUU. So there is your P site here and A site here. Now when I say P site, the initiator codon is already present there. When I say initiator codon, you remember UAC having the amino acid methionine, right? Then the second site over here, this is in case of larger subunit. Please note, this is in your larger subunit, not in the smaller. Smaller subunit is reading, larger subunit is giving sites. Whereas A site is allowing for the next tRNA to come, specific tRNA, okay, that is having anticodon AAA, right, which is complementary to UUU, and it will have the specific amino acid. So UUU codes for phenylalanine, so I'm writing P right now, okay. So this is how it incomes. What this peptide site or P site will do is, it will remove this and bind to the next tRNA with the help of peptide bond. So binding is with the help of peptide bond. An enzyme is there, okay. So please remember, that's how it is done. So as the ribosome moves from AUG, UUU, GUG. So imagine the ribosome has now moved till here. Okay. So what happens here? This is your P site. This is your A site. Now it is allowing for the next. Now third tRNA is coming. So third tRNA having the anticodon CAC. That codes for valine. GUG codes for valine. So you're getting the idea? So previous one after bonding, so you just remember, first one was methionine, and then phenylalanine. So here it is valine. Now next bonding, now this P, the phenylalanine, is along with methionine, is bound to valine with the help of peptide bond. So that is all done by the P site. So you have got the idea. There is A site for the incoming tRNA. There is P site. Okay, it is P site for the peptide bond formation. There is E site, which I'm not explaining. That is not told in your textbook. E site means exit site. So I hope you can get the idea. When I say E site, you can observe clearly, it exits. Okay, it exits. The empty tRNA exits. So it's better I show you here. See, it's clearly shown here how the tRNA is lost without any amino acid. Earlier it was with amino acid, charged amino acid that comes in and then gone. So you can see how the polypeptide chain that has been formed. So this is your bonding. P site to A site bonding takes place, peptide bond formation. So as the ribosome moves forward, there is your exit site. So in that exit site, the old tRNA is removed, it gets exist. Now that's what I've written here. A site for subsequent tRNA carrying specific amino acid to bind. P site, formation of peptide bond to the amino acid of previous tRNA. And ribosome 70S in case of prokaryotes reads in the direction 5' to 3', and as it reads, polypeptide chain is produced. So this is what the explanation is. So any doubts you have, you let me know. So I'm just reading it for clarity. Ribosome proceeds to the elongation phase of protein synthesis. This is actually this I gave introductory part to make you understand what is the sites and how it is read. So in the elongation steps, these are your steps. Ribosome proceeds to the elongation. So ribosome reads in the direction 5 prime to 3 prime. You can shorten the whole answer. So elongation, so ribosome proceeds to the elongation phase of the protein synthesis. This is your protein synthesis. Translation is your protein synthesis. So we are saying elongation phase now. So what happens? Complexes composed of an amino acid like linked to tRNA. So amino acid linked to tRNA sequentially bind. Why sequentially? According to the codon. So that's what, bind to the appropriate codon in mRNA by forming complementary base pairs with the tRNA anticodon. It is specific. So, as the ribosome moves from codon to codon along the mRNA, amino acids are added one by one. Okay. So, this is actually one sentence. As the ribosome moves from codon to codon, amino acids are added one by one and translated into polypeptide sequences dictated by DNA and represented by mRNA. To give you a better idea what this sentence is, dictated is actually the code given by DNA. It is represented by mRNA. That's how you got your product, polypeptide sequence. Okay. So, I hope it is clear. Then it is your termination step. As you know, there are some regions which are, you know, not coded. So, there are certain regions which are called as UTR, untranslated regions. So, some are your stop codons, that is your UAA, UGA, UAG, which does not code for any amino acid. So along with this release factors, okay, it binds to the stop codons and hence it will terminate the translation. That's how finally it will release the polypeptide from the ribosome and hence it is immediately used for the function. Okay, so this is all your pictures which I've given. Please note, this is a diagram. This is the diagram that is asked along with the question for the explanation of explain the process of translation in prokaryotes or eukaryotes. Both you have to mention the same process except the ribosomal units, whether it is ATS or 70S. Okay, so any doubts, please let me know. Please note, this is the diagram for your translation process. No other diagrams, whichever I've given here, these diagrams are not needed. It is only for your idea, not needed at all. Okay, these are not needed. Only the one for which I showed, this should be there. Okay, this should be there. I hope it is clear. Yes. Any doubts, please let me know. It is an important question. Okay. Thank you.